coming to you in the name of Jesus. We want to thank you, Heavenly Father, for allowing us to come together on your Sabbath day, Heavenly Father, the days that have a holy convocation, so we learn more about you. And as your word goes for us, Heavenly Father, give us to understand, Lord God, not just understand your word, Lord God, but also apply it to our lives. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
The title of today's lesson is, The Bible Reads Different When You Know Who the Israelites Are. The Bible reads different when you know who the Israelites are. And as we do every Sabbath day, we're going to read Psalms 119, 165, and 176. Psalms 119, 165, and 176. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Lord, I have hope for thy salvation and done thy commandments. My soul hath kept thy testimonies, and I love them exceedingly. I have kept thy precepts and thy testimonies, for all my ways are before thee. Let my cry come near before thee, O Lord. Give me understanding according to thy word. Let my supplication come before thee. Deliver me according to thy word. My lips shall utter praise when thou hast taught me thy statutes. My tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. Let thy hand help me, for I have chosen thy precepts. I have longed for thy salvation, O Lord, and the law is my delight. Let my soul live, and it shall praise thee, and let thy judgments help me. I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek thy servant, for I'll not forget thy commandments. Amen. So dealing with the lesson again, the Bible reads different when you know who the Israelites are, because right now the whole world is being deceived, and they're thinking that those Edomites in the land of Israel are the true Jews right now. But then the Bible also lets us know that when the true Israelites are in the land, there's going to be peace in the land. But we're seeing nothing but bloodshed in the land. So now we're going to break this down from the beginning, the separation of Esau and Israel, which is Jacob or the Israelites. Let's go to Genesis 25. Genesis 25, 19 through 34. Because I'm saying, because like, if you're thinking that the Israelites are already in the land, you'll have a lack of understanding of the Bible, because it's like the Bible says one thing about the children of Israel being in the land when there's going to be peace and the Messiah is going to be here, but yet, how can they be in the land when Jesus is not here yet? And he said he's going to be the one that's going to gather us and put us back into our land. So Genesis 25, 19 through 34. When you get there, go ahead.
And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Padanaram, the sister to Laban, the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren.
So when he said he entreated, it means he pleaded with the Lord because his wife was barren because she wouldn't have a child. So he was pleading for the Lord for her to have a child. This was going to happen. Go ahead.
And the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. And the children struggled together within her, and she said, If it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord, and the Lord said unto her, Two nations are in thy womb, and the two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels, and the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red all over like in hairy garment. And they call his name Esau.
So you see that Esau, he's being described as being in red. First came out red and all, he said, all over like a hairy garment. And they called his name Esau. Why? Because the reason why their head is like with Europeans. They're not white. They're actually red because you can see the blood through their skin. But you see that they described them. He described him. But he didn't have to describe Jacob coming out because they were already black at the time. So there was no need to describe Jacob, but he was putting that different because remember, even though they were twins, it was still two different nations in Rebekah's womb. Go ahead.
And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob, and Esau was 80 years old when she bare them.
But remember though, even though like I said, they came in, even though people think that Edomites are Europeans, they're not. They're actually Shemitic. The same way how Europeans are the same way how Edomites are white like the Europeans, the same way how us, we're Shemitic, but yet we're dark like the Hamites or Africans, but yet we're actually brothers, but we're still two different nations, and we're not the same, but we were still considered twins unto God. Go ahead.
And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents, and Isaac loved Esau, because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. And Jacob sighed pottage, and Esau came from the field, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, Feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom.
So that's when his name went from Esau to Edom right there. All right, go ahead.
And Jacob said, Sell me show this birthright due to me. And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he sware unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils, and he did eat and drink and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright.
Thus Esau despised his birthright. So now let's go ahead and go to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, we're going to go 14 through 17. Hebrews chapter 12, 14 through 17. But you can also put your finger back on Genesis 27 because we're going to turn right back to Genesis. But Hebrews chapter 12, 14 through 17. Hebrews chapter 12, 14 through 17. When you get there, go ahead.
Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled, lest there be any fornication or profane person, as Esau.
As Esau,
who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright.
Sold it, because he didn't really care about his birthright. Go ahead.
For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears.
Though he sought it carefully with tears. Remember, he despised his birthright. He didn't care, because he gave it up, because he thought he was going to die. Just because he was hungry. He wasn't going to die, but he didn't really care about his birthright like that. So now let's go back to Genesis 27. Let's go back to Genesis. We're going to read Genesis chapter 27, 5 through 39. Genesis 27, 5 through 39. When you get there, go ahead. Genesis 27, 5 through 39. Go ahead.
And Rebekah heard when Isaac spake to Esau, his son. And Esau went to the field to hunt for venison, and to bring it. And Rebekah spake unto Jacob, her son, saying, behold, I heard thy father speak unto Esau, thy brother, saying, bring me venison, and make me savory meat, that I may eat and bless thee before the Lord, before my death. Now therefore, my son, obey my voice according to that which I command thee. Go now to the flock, and fetch me from thence two good kids of the goats, and I will make them savory meat for thy father, such as he loveth. And thou shalt bring it to thy father, that he may eat, and that he may bless thee before his death. And Jacob said to Rebekah his mother, behold, Esau my brother is a hairy man, and I am a smooth man. My father peradventure will fill me, and I shall seem to him as a deceiver, and I shall bring a curse upon me, and not a blessing.
Remember though, see what Rebekah already knew, because God already told her that the blessing was going to go to who? To Jacob, not Esau. Remember, he already sold his birthright anyway, so he didn't really care about his birthright. So go ahead, that's key. Go ahead, 13.
And his mother said unto him, upon me be thy curse, my son, only obey my voice, and go fetch me them. And he went and fetched and brought them to his mother. And his mother made savory meat such as his father loved. And Rebekah took goodly raiment of her eldest son Esau, which were with her in the house, and put them upon Jacob, her younger son. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats upon his head, and upon the smooth of his neck. And she gave the savory meat and the bread, which she had prepared, into the hand of her son Jacob. And he came unto his father, and said, my father. And he said, here am I. Who art thou, my son? My son? And Jacob said unto his father, I am Esau, thy firstborn. I have done according as thou badest me. Arise, I pray thee, sit and eat of my venison, that thy soul may bless me. And Isaac said unto his son, how is it that thou hast found it so quickly, my son? And he said, because the Lord thy God brought it to me. And Isaac said unto Jacob, come near, I pray thee, that I may feel thee, my son, whether thou be my very son Esau or not. And Jacob went near unto Isaac his father, and he felt him, and said, the voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau.
Remember, his eyes were dim because he couldn't hardly see, so he understood the voice, but he was like, okay, well, hold on. He was questioning it, but when he felt the hair on him, because he was hairy, so okay, that has to be my son Esau. But go ahead.
And he discerned him not, because his hands were hairy, and his brother's Esau's hands. And he said, art thou my very son Esau? And he said, I am. And he said, bring it near to me, and I will eat of my son's venison, that my soul may bless thee. And he brought it near to him, and he did eat. And he brought him wine, and he drank. And his father Isaac said unto him, come near now, and kiss me, my son. And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled of his raiment, and blessed him, and said, see the smell of my son, as is the smell of the field, which the Lord hath blessed. Therefore God give thee of the dew of heaven.
See, that was smart, because he understood that he had to smell his clothes, because he knew that, remember, Jacob was a man who dwelled in the tents. He wasn't out there going out hunting like Esau. So when he had Esau's clothes on, he smelled, he said, okay, I'm feeling the hair. I smell the clothes of Esau. Even though you sound like Jacob, you have to be Esau. I mean, you have to, even though you sounded like Jacob, he must be Esau, because you can smell his clothes and the hair that his mom put on him. But go ahead.
And the fatness of the earth, and plenty of corn and wine. Let people serve thee, and nations bow down to thee. Be Lord over thy brethren, and let thy mother's son bow down to thee. Cursed be everyone that curseth thee, and blessed be he that blesseth thee. And it came to pass, as soon as Isaac had made an end of blessing Jacob, and Jacob was yet scarce gone out from the presence of Isaac his father, that Esau's brother came in from his hunting. And he also had made savory meat, and brought it unto his father, and said unto his father, let my father arise and eat of his son's venison, that thy soul may bless me.
Now Esau knew, he knew he sold the birthright, you know what I'm saying, for some pottage meat, but yet he still wanted to get that blessing. So he was the one that was in the wrong, because he should have said, like, look, Dad, I sold my birthright to, you know, to Jacob. But he didn't do that, though. He wanted it all. He was greedy. But go ahead.
And Isaac his father said unto him, who art thou? And he said, I am thy son, thy firstborn Esau. Mm. And Isaac trembled very exceedingly and said, who? Where is he that hath taken venison and brought it me? And I have eaten of all before thou camest, and have blessed him. Yea, and he shall be blessed. And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry, and said unto his father, bless me, even me also, O my father. Mm. And he said, thy brother came with subtlety,
or with deceit,
and have taken away thy blessing. Mm. And he said, is not he rightly named Jacob? For he hath supplanted me these two times.
He said he supplanted me deceived me two times. And what did it say? What? He did what?
He took away my birthright.
He ain't taking away his birthright, because he sold it. So he didn't take it. He actually sold it. He thought he was going to die of hunger, because he didn't, remember, he despised his birthright. What else?
And behold, now he hath taken away my blessing. Mm. And he said, hast thou not reserved a blessing for me? Mm-hmm. And Isaac answered and said unto Esau, behold, I have made him thy lord, and all his brethren have I given to him for servants, and with corn and wine I have sustained him. And what shall I do now unto thee, my son? And Esau said unto his father, hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. And Isaac his father answered and said unto him, behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth, and of the dew of heaven from above. And by thy sword shall thou live, and shall serve thy brother. And it shall come to pass, when thou shalt have the dominion, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck.
So it says, verse 39, it says, and Isaac his father answered and said unto him, behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth, and the dew of heaven from above. So therefore, that's why they have a lot of wealth and stuff right now. But some people try to say, well, you know what? They have to be the Jews or chosen people of God, because they're blessed with financial gain and stuff like that. But like, no, remember, he said that was part of the blessing. And it also says, and by the sword thou shalt live. That's why, even though that little nation over there, even though they took our land, yet those, they can fight, you know what I'm saying? Because all those nations around them, they're still able to fight them. But now people are trying to say, well, you know, that's God's hand upon them, and God is fighting for them. True to a sense, because when you read Daniel chapter 11, God said that he was going to spare Edom, Ammon, and Moab, because he wants to deal with them when he comes back by himself. So he's making sure these other nations won't destroy those nations, because he wants to deal with him himself. So therefore, but you see how good that they can fight, though. They have one of the top militaries in the world, for them to be such a small nation, though. So now, let's go ahead and go, because now, because like I said, when we read later on, we're going to see that the children of Israel, we won't be able to fight our enemy, because he said the enemies will come in one way, we'll flee seven ways, so therefore we won't have the military to fight for our own. So that's how you know that those people have an excellent military. That's how you know those Edomites can't be the Jews, because they said we can't do it while speaking of these curses. We won't be able to fight these for ourselves, because we'll be a downtrodden people, but those Edomites can still fight them. So now let's go ahead and go where God makes a covenant with our people right here. Exodus 24. Exodus 24, 1 through 8. 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 And when you get there, go ahead.
And he said unto Moses, come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship thee afar off. And Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord, and all the judgments, and all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord hath said will we do. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord, and rose up early in the morning, and built an altar under the hill, and 12 pillars, according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the children of Israel, which offer burnt offerings, and sacrifice peace offerings of oxen unto the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood, and put it in basins, and half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. And he took the book of the covenant, and read in the audience of the people. And they said, all that the Lord hath said will we do, and be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people, and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words.
So that's the covenant right there. Then also you can see in Psalms 105, starting at verse 6, I believe, see, Psalms 105, verse 6, where it says, O ye seed of Abraham, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen. He is the Lord our God, his judges are in all the earth. He has remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to 1,000 generations, which covenant he made with Abraham, his oath unto Isaac, and confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law, and to Israel for an everlasting covenant. That's why when God says that he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he don't say I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Esau, or Abraham, Isaac, and or Abraham, Isaac, Ishmael, or like that. He says Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, because that's the covenant that he has, that he made with us right there, with our forefathers. So now let's go and go to Deuteronomy 27. Deuteronomy 27, we read 9 and 10. Deuteronomy 27, verses 9 and 10. Deuteronomy 27, verses 9 and 10. Go ahead.
And Moses and the priests, the Levites, spake unto all Israel, saying, take heed and hearken, O Israel, this day thou art become the people of the Lord thy God. Thou shalt therefore obey the voice of the Lord thy God, and do his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day.
14 through 26.
And the Levites shall speak, and say unto all the men of Israel,
go ahead,
with a loud voice, cursed be the man that maketh any graven or molten image, an abomination unto the Lord, the work of the hands of the craftsman, and putteth it in a secret place.
Mm-hmm.
And all the people shall answer and say, amen.
Yes.
Cursed be he that setteth light by his father or his mother. And all the people shall say, amen.
When it says, cursed is he that setteth light, means to dishonor by his father's mother, and all the people shall say, amen. What else?
Cursed be he that removeth his neighbor's landmark.
Uh-huh.
And all the people shall say, amen.
Mm-hmm.
Cursed be he that maketh the blind to wander out of the way. And all the people shall say, amen.
Mm-hmm.
Cursed be he that perverteth the judgment of the stranger, fatherless, and widow. And all the people shall say, amen.
Mm-hmm.
Cursed be he that lieth with his father's wife, because he uncovered his father's skirt.
That means it's bad. That means that, like you said, if you're sleeping with your father's wife, you can't do that. Go ahead.
And all the people shall say, amen.
Uh-huh.
Cursed be he that lieth with any manner of beast. And all the people shall say, amen.
Mm-hmm.
Cursed be he that lieth with his sister, the daughter of his father, or the daughter of his mother, and all the people shall say, amen. Cursed be he that lieth with his mother-in-law, and all the people shall say, amen.
Mm-hmm.
Cursed be he that smiteth his neighbor secretly, and all the people shall say, Amen. Cursed be he that taketh reward to slay an innocent person. And all the people shall say, Amen. Cursed be he that confirmeth not all the words of this law to do them. And all the people shall say, Amen.
Amen. Remember, we made a covenant, so all the things that we said we're going to do, we're supposed to do. Now, watch this very next chapter, Deuteronomy 28:1-20. Deuteronomy 28:1-20. Because, see, we were being obedient. We were supposed to have the blessings right now, not the curse, but unfortunately, we disobeyed our God. But these are supposed to be the blessings that we're supposed to have as a nation right here. Go ahead. Deuteronomy 28:1.
And it shall come to pass, if thou hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed.
When it talks about blessed be the fruit of thy body, that means your children. The women, when they have children, we talk about the breasts. Blessed be the fruit of thy body. Some of the children. Go ahead.
Blessed shall be thy baskets and thy store. Mm-hmm. Blessed shall thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shall thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. Mm-hmm. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways. Mm. The Lord shall command the blessing upon thee in thy storehouses and in all that setteth thine hand unto. And he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. The Lord shall establish thee an holy people unto himself, as he hath sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways. And all people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of thee. And the Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods, and the fruit of the body of thy body, and in the fruit of thy cattle, and in the fruit of thy ground, in the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers to give thee. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure, the heaven to give the rain unto thy land in this season, and to bless all the work of thine hand. And thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. And the Lord shall make thee the head and not the tail. And thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath. Mm-hmm. If thou hearken unto the
commandments,
if thou hearken unto the commandments of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day to observe and to do them, and thou shalt not go aside from any of the words which I command thee this day to the right hand or to the left, or go after other gods to serve them. Mm-hmm. But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken,
if thou wilt not now hearken to the Lord thy God, go ahead,
to the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Cursed shall thou be in the city, mm-hmm. and cursed shall thou be in the field. Cursed shall thy basket be thy basket in thy store. Mm. Cursed shall be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy land, and the increase of thy kind.
Kinds of cows, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. And the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shall thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shall thou be when thou goest out. Mm-hmm. The Lord shall send upon thee cursing, vexation, and rebuke, and all that thou settest thy hand unto for to do unto, until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou hast forsaken me.
Read 25 to 33.
The Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Uh-huh. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, uh-huh. and shall be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth.
Yep.
And thy carcass shall be meat unto all the fowls of the air and unto the beasts of the earth, and no man shall pray them away. The Lord will smite thee with the botch of Egypt, and with the emerods, and with the scab, and with the itch, whereof thou canst not be healed. Mm. The Lord will smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart, and thou shalt grope at noonday and blind as the blind gropeth in darkness, and thou shalt not prosper in thy ways, and thou shalt only oppressed and spoiled evermore. Mm. And no man shall save thee.
And no man's going to save us, meaning that no man's going to redeem us, because the only one's going to redeem us out of this captivity is Jesus. No man's going to do this except Jesus. But go ahead. 30.
Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Mm. Thou shalt build an house, and thou shalt not dwell therein. Thou shalt plant a vineyard, and thou shalt not gather the grapes thereof. Thine ox shall be slain before thine eyes, and thou shalt not eat thereof. Thine ass shall be violently taken away from before thy face, and thou shalt not be restored of thee. Thy sheep shall be given unto thine enemies, and thou shalt have none to rescue them. Thine sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people. Mm. Thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long. And there shall be no might in thine hand.
So we saw that like I said, we understand that happened also in 586 BC, but it also happened even during our time, because when you look and see, you'll see like Negroes for sale. You know, it's like they were selling our children, the wife would go this way, the man would go this way, and then the children would go another way. So we were constantly being sold. So like I said, that's why we didn't have a good family structure. And that's what happened. That's why I said that sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and was filled with longing for them all the day long. But go ahead.
The fruit of thy land and all thy labor shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up, and thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed always.
So it says the fruit of thy land, which is talking about Israel, and all thy laborers shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up. And that's what they're doing. Remember, these Gentiles are devouring and trotting down Jerusalem right now. They're enjoying that stuff there, but where we are in captivity at this time, though. So now go ahead and go read 43.
The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low.
So even like in our communities, even though we're in captivity, we can have our communities where, you know, like a black community, but yet you'll have Arabs in there, you'll have Chinese in there, they can come and set up businesses in our area and prosper off of us, but coming into our neighborhoods. But yet, if we try to build up our own business, something like that, our people will not patronize each other, but we'll buy from another nation. But God said that's going to happen. He said, the stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. 47.
Because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart, for the abundance of all things. Mm-hmm. Therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee, in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and in want of all things.
That's what I said. We have to go to the Gentiles for everything now, because we don't have any power now, because we're in the land of our captivity. But go ahead.
And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck,
until
he have destroyed thee.
Yes.
The Lord shall bring a nation against thee from afar, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flight. Mm-hmm. A nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand, a nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, or show favor to the young, and he shall eat the fruit of thy cattle and the fruit of thy land until thou be destroyed, which also shall not leave thee either corn, wine, or oil, or the increase of thy kind, or flocks of thy sheep, until he have destroyed thee. Mm-hmm. And he shall besiege thee in all thy gates, until thy high and fenced walls come down, wherein thou trustest throughout all thy land. And he shall besiege thee in all thy gates throughout all thy land, which the Lord thy God hath given thee, and thou shalt eat the fruit of thy own body, the flesh of thy sons and of thy daughters, which the Lord thy God hath given thee, in the siege and in the straitness wherewith thine enemies shall distress thee.
So that also happened in 70 AD. So what they did was, put a camp around this. So just imagine, so nothing can come in and nothing come out. So they couldn't get any food to come in. So when they seized up Jerusalem from like 67 AD to 70 AD, if there was no food, the children, the mothers and the father, they were eating their own children. You know what I'm saying? Because they didn't have anything else to eat. So that's what I said. And thou shalt eat the fruit of thy own body, the flesh of thy sons and thy daughters, which the Lord thy God giveth thee, in the siege, in the straitness wherein thy enemies shall distress thee. So they were eating their own children. All this stuff is coming to pass for what God said, if we're disobedient to him. Keep going. Yeah, and read 54. Go ahead.
So that the man that is tender among you and very delicate, his eyes shall be evil toward his brother and toward the wife of his bosom and toward the remnant of his children, which he shall leave.
So, right. So So when you look at it right now, it's like, even though, like, for some reason, that's why a lot of people say, why does it seem like our people don't have a love for each other? Men, like, we'll look at some another black man or a black woman looking at another black woman, and they can't stand that woman for whatever reason. Well, one, we see because of the curses. That's why it says we have an evil eye towards his brother. And then it says the wife of his bosom, toward the remnant of his children, which he shall lead. That's why, for the most part, like, you have people, you know, you have single parents in other nations, but it's more prevalent in our people because God said that the man is going to be with the woman. As he's with the woman, they'll have children, and he's going to lead. You see it more prevalent in our community, in our society, than any other nation because it's written. Now read from 64 to 68.
And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people from the one end of the earth even into the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone.
And that's what we're doing right now. We're serving other gods. We're serving that, you know, Islam. We're serving, like I said, Roman Christianity. We're in Buddhism, Hinduism. We're in all these different religions except serving the one true God. Go ahead.
And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. For the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even, and at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning. For at the fear, for the fear of thine heart, therewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee. Thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bond men and bond women, and no man shall buy you.
Right, so it says, and the Lord shall bring thee again into Egypt with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee, and thou shalt see it no more again, and there shall be sold unto your enemies for bond men and bond women, which were slaves, and no man shall buy you. This word buy means to redeem, because remember, we were already sold. But yet, we were not able to be redeemed, because when you read Leviticus chapter 25, you were able to buy and redeem a loved one who was sold as a slave. You were able to do that. But God said, no, he's going to be the one to redeem us, not man. So now let's go ahead and go to 2 Kings chapter 17, because see, now we're going to see, because before when Saul was our first king, and then David and Solomon, all Israel's together. But when Solomon disobeyed God, he split the kingdom into two. He had the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. He gave the kingdoms to Rehoboam and Jeroboam, Solomon's son. So now we're going to see, when we say how they're going to go into captivity. So we're going to see the northern kingdom at this time in 722 BC under the Assyrians go into captivity, and they never went back into the land. So 2 Kings 17, 10 to 24. 2 Kings 17, 10 to 24. 2 Kings 17, 10 through 24. 2 Kings 17, 10 through 24. When you get there, go ahead.
And they set them up images and groves in every high hill and under every green tree. And there they burnt incense in all the high places, as did the heathen whom the Lord carried away before them, and wrought wicked things to provoke the Lord to an anger. For they served idols, whereof the Lord had said unto them, you shall not do this thing.
Remember, because God already kicked out those seven Hebetic nations that were doing this prior to that. And he said, do not learn their ways. And that's what we started doing. We're doing the same thing that those nations that God kicked out, we're doing the same thing that they were doing. Go ahead.
Yet the Lord testified against Israel and against Judah by all the prophets and by all the seers, saying, turn ye from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes according to all the law which I commanded your fathers, and which I sent to you by my servants, the prophets. Notwithstanding, they would not hear, but hardened their necks, like to the neck of their fathers, that did not believe in the Lord their God. And they rejected his statutes and his covenant that he made with their fathers, and his testimonies, which he testified against them. And they followed vanity, and became vain, and went after the heathen that were round about them, concerning whom the Lord had charged them, that they should not do like them. And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God, and made them molten images, even two calves, and made a grove, and worshipped all the hosts of heaven and served Baal. And they caused their sons their daughters to pass through the fire and use divination and enchantments and sold themselves to the to do evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. Therefore the Lord was very angry with Israel and removed them out of his sight. There was none left but the tribe of Judah only. Mm-hmm. Also, Judah kept not the commandments of the Lord their God, but walked in the statutes of Israel, which they made. And the Lord rejected all the seed of Israel and afflicted them, and delivered them into the hand of the of spoilers, mm-hmm. until he had cast them out of his sight. For he rent Israel from the house of David, and they made Jeroboam the son of Nebat king. And Jeroboam drave Israel from following the Lord, and made them sin, a great sin.
Yeah.
For the children of Israel walked in all the sins of Jeroboam, which he did. They departed not from them until the Lord removed Israel out of his sight, as he had said by all his servants and the prophets. So was Israel carried away out of their own land to Assyria unto this day.
So remember, so in 722, when the northern kingdom got kicked out, they never went back into the land. And this is, and these are the people right now who are like they're in the land right now, and they're thinking that they're Jews, but they're actually not. Verse 24.
And the king of Assyria brought men from Babylon,
uh-huh.
and from Cutta,
uh-huh.
and from Ava, and from Hamath, and from Sepharvaim,
uh-huh.
and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel. And they possessed Samaria and dwelt in the cities thereof.
There you go. So, right. So, therefore, so that's in the northern part. Those are the people right there in Israel right now, but they think that they're Jews, but they're actually not, because they came from other nations. Remember, the northern kingdom never went back. So now we're going to read what happened in 586 BC with Nebuchadnezzar, how Judah got kicked out of the land now. Judah got kicked out of the land. So now let's go ahead and go to 2 Chronicles 36. 2 Chronicles 36, 11 through 23. 2 Chronicles 36, 11 through 23. So we see the northern kingdom was kicked out in 722 BC. Now right here, it's 536 B.C., we're going to see the southern kingdom kicked out of the land as well. Remember, they said that we're going to be kicked out of the land, going to captivity, because we broke the commandments. Right here, 2 Chronicles 36, 11 to 23. Go ahead.
Zedekiah was 1 and 20 years old when he began to reign, and reigned 11 years in Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord his God, and humbled not himself before Jeremiah the prophet speaking from the mouth of the Lord. And he also rebelled against King Nebuchadnezzar, who had made him swear by God, but he stiffened his neck and hardened his heart from turning unto the Lord God of Israel.
Because you can read in Jeremiah chapter 27, we're supposed to obey Nebuchadnezzar. But Zedekiah said, he's not obeying him, so he didn't do it. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar was, this right here is the time of the Gentiles. So Nebuchadnezzar, so you got Babylon, you had the Medes and the Persians, which was the Russians and the and Iranians. Then you had the Greek, and you had the Romans. Those are the Gentile nations. Those are the European nations. So therefore, this is their time. This is when they started ruling at this time. So I'm sure Zedekiah is looking at this European, and they said, hold on, I got to serve them. He didn't want to do it, but God told him to still do it anyway because of our disobedience. But they didn't do it, so what's going to happen? Keep going.
Moreover, all the chief of the priests and the people transgressed very much after the abominations of the heathen and polluted the house of the Lord, which he had hallowed in Jerusalem. And the Lord God of their fathers sent to them by the messengers rising up times and sending, because he had compassion on his people.
So he had compassion for us. That's why he was constantly sending prophets to tell us to keep the commandments of God, to keep the Sabbath day, do all these different things, but we did not want to do it. So go ahead.
And on his dwelling place.
Uh-huh.
But they mocked the messengers of God,
mm-hmm.
and despised his words,
uh-huh.
and misused his prophets until the wrath of the Lord arose against his people.
Right.
Till there was no remedy.
Right. He had enough. He said, you know what? Hey, I had enough now. Go ahead.
Therefore he brought upon them the king of the Chaldees, who slew their young men with the sword in the house of their sanctuary, and had no compassion upon young man or maiden,
mm.
old man or him that stooped for age. He gave them all unto his hand.
So it didn't matter if it was a child, it was a woman, old men, old women, they didn't care. They killed everybody. Go ahead.
And all the vessels of the house of God, great and small, and the treasures of the treasures of the house of God, and the treasures of the king and his princes, and all these he brought to Babylon, and they burnt the house of God, and he broke down the wall of Jerusalem and burnt all the palaces thereof with fire, and destroyed all the goodly vessels thereof. And them that had escaped from the sword carried he away to Babylon, where they were his servants to him, and his sons, until he reigned of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah until...
Yeah, you can read that, and also in Jeremiah 25, where it says that we're going to be in the land of captivity for 70 years. Go ahead.
Until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths for as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years.
Uh-huh.
Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, the word of the Lord spoken by the mouth of Jeremiah might be accomplished. And the Lord stirred up the spirits of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom, and put it also in writing, saying, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth hath the Lord God of heaven given me, and he hath changed me to build him an house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is there among you of all his people? The Lord his God, the Lord his God be with him, and let him go up.
Amen. So right, so after the 7 years were accomplished, so now he's sending the children of Israel back into Judah, back into the land of Judah, so that now they can go ahead and build up a temple for the Lord. So now let's go and go to Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9, we're going to read 9 to 26. Daniel chapter 9, 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 9 to 26. When you get there, go ahead.
To the Lord our God belong mercies and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him.
Mm-hmm.
Neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws, which he set before us by his servants, the prophets. Yea, all Israel have transgressed thy law, even by departing, that they might not obey thy voice. Therefore the curse is poured upon us, and the oath that is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, because we have sinned against him.
So right, so remember, we read Deuteronomy chapter 27, Deuteronomy chapter 28, we saw the blessing and the curses, but you see, now all those curses that were written in the word of in the law of Moses, now they're like I said, that they now they came against our people, and he's confirming the words now of what's happening with Daniel. Go ahead.
And he hath confirmed his words which he spake against us,
uh-huh,
and against our judges that judged us,
uh-huh,
by bringing upon us a great evil.
Yes.
For under the whole heaven have not been done as hath been done upon Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
As it is written in the law of Moses, all this evil is come upon us. Yet made we not our prayers before the Lord our God, that we might turn from our iniquities and understand thy truth.
Yes.
Therefore hath the Lord watched upon the evil and brought it upon us. For the Lord our God is righteous, and all his works which he doeth, for we obey not his voice.
Mm-hmm.
And now, O Lord our God, that has brought thy people forth out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand, and has gotten thee renown as at this day we have sinned,
mm-hmm,
we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let thine anger and thy fury be turned away from thy city, Jerusalem, thy holy mountain, because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers. Jerusalem and thy people are become a reproach to all that are about us. Now therefore, O our God, hear the prayer of thy servant and his supplications, and cause thy face to shine upon thy sanctuary that is desolate, for the Lord's sake. O my God, incline thine ear and hear. Open thine eyes and behold our desolations, and the city which is called by thy name. For we do not present our supplications before thee for our righteousness, but for thy great mercy.
Yes.
O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, hearken, and do not, and do. Defer not.
He said, and defer not means do not delay. Go ahead.
For thine own sake.
Yes.
O my God, for thy city and thy people are called by thy name,
which is Israel. Go ahead.
And while I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God, yea, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding.
Mm-hmm.
At the beginning of thy supplications, the commandment came forth, and I am come are determined upon
70,
thy people.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, 70 weeks
yes.
are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy.
So, see, 70 weeks are determined now because remember, we're in captivity for 70 years. So now Daniel's trying to understand, okay, it's after 7 years. It went from 7 years to the 70 weeks of years. And we read in the Bible, a week is considered 7 years. So we say 7 years, that's the 490 years right here. Because right here. So now look at verse 25. Go ahead.
Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks.
So that's 483 years. Go ahead.
The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times.
Mm-hmm.
And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war, desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week.
Well, that was it. Okay, right here. Verse 26, so it says, and after 62 weeks shall the Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince, which was Rome at this time, they shall come and destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end of the earth shall be with a flood or with the army, and until the end of the war, the desolations are determined. So you're saying that when Rome came in 70 AD, this happened in 70 AD, when they came in and destroyed Jerusalem and the sanctuary, that happened. But you're still seeing, like I said, like I'm not going to get, it's too deep right here to go into the 70 weeks of Daniel. But just know that it's still like 3.5 years that Jesus has to finish up to confirm the 490 weeks. But we're seeing right here that in verse 26 that how the Messiah had to be cut off. So the Messiah had to die before Jerusalem and the temple was destroyed. Now Jesus is going to quote this right here. Let's go now to Luke chapter 21. Luke 21, we're going to read 20 to 24. Luke 21. 20 to 24. Luke 21, 20 to
24.
Luke 21,
20 to 24.
Luke 21,
20 to 24.
And when you get there, go ahead.
And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days.
Mm-hmm.
For there shall be great distress in the land, and wrath upon his people, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled.
So it says that they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive to all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Meaning that the Gentiles are going to have a time to rule and their time is going to rule. And then when Jesus comes back, he's going to put an end to their kingdom. He's going to set up his everlasting kingdom here on earth. So right now, you see that Jerusalem is trodden down. So therefore, the Jews cannot be in the land because he said that Jerusalem will be trodden down to the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So now let's go ahead and go to Obadiah. Obadiah chapter 1. Because see, now we're going to see what these Edomites did. So when we went to captivity, the Edomites said, you know what? Now it's our time. Because remember, Edom always wanted the blessing anyway. So now he's trying to say, okay, since we're in captivity, they can have the whole world deceived, and now they're up under the guise of being Jews now instead of being Edomites, but we know who they are. But yet, the world believes that those are the people of the book, and that they're Jews, and the prophets expose them to show they are not God's chosen people. They're actually Edomites, but they're under the guise of Jews right now. Obadiah chapter 1. Obadiah, well, it's only one chapter. Obadiah 1, read verses 1 through 6. Go ahead.
The vision of Obadiah. Thus saith the Lord concerning Edom. We have heard a rumor from the Lord, and an ambassador is sent among the heathen. Arise ye, and let us arise up against her in battle. Behold, I have made thee small among the heathen. Thou art greatly despised.
So he says, behold, I have made thee small among the heathen. Thou thou art great and despised. When you look at the world population, it's about 8 billion people on this planet, but yet the Edomites make up between 15 to 20 million of the population. That's less than 1%. So you see that they're small among the nations, and they are greatly despised. They're also hated. But people think, oh, they're only hated because they're God's chosen people. No, they're hated because God said that they're the border of wickedness. Because when you read about Edom in Malachi chapter 1, where he says this, he says, the burden of the Lord, the burden of the word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi, I have loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, whereas have he loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord? Yet I loved Jacob, and I hated Esau, and laid his mountains and heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness. Whereas Edom saith, we are impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places. Thus say the Lord of hosts, they shall build, but I will throw down, and they shall call them the border of wickedness. See, God calls them the border of wickedness, and the people against whom the Lord hath indignation forever. See, God, like, he despises Edom because he understands that Edom has taken our land and got the whole world to see, believing that there are that God's chosen people, and they're not. You know, it's like that, and God understands that. But go ahead. Where are we at now?
The pride of thine heart.
Verse 3. Yeah.
Verse 3. The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, that dwelleth in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, Who shall bring me down to the ground? Though thou exalt thyself as the eagle, and though thou set thy nest among the stars, mm-hmm. thence will I bring thee down, saith the Lord. If these came to thee, if robbers by night, how art thou cut off? Would they not have stolen till they had enough? If the grape gatherers came to thee, would they have not left some grapes? How are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hidden things sought up?
So he says right here, he says, if these came to thee, and if robbers by night, how art thou cut off? Would they not have stolen till they have had enough? So like he said, you know, like when someone break into your house, you know, they'll steal your TV, your Xbox, and things like that. Well, they stole everything. They wanted, like Esau, they wanted the furniture, they wanted the refrigerator, they wanted the food. They took everything. So he's like, hold on. So Esau, like, they took everything from us. And God's like, hell, that's why he says, how are the things of Esau searched out? How are the hidden things sought up? Now read from verse 10. 10 through 15. Go ahead. 10 through 15.
For thy violence against thy brother, Jacob, shame shall cover thee,
uh-huh.
and thou shalt be cut off forever.
Mm, now watch this now. Go ahead.
In the day that thou stoodest on the other side,
uh-huh.
in the day that the strangers carried away captive his forces, and the foreigners entered into his gates, and cast lots upon Jerusalem, even thou was as one of them.
Right, so they were one of us. So when the Romans came in 70 AD to take our land, they were also conspiring against the Romans because they understood they wanted our land anyway, so that was perfect for them because they wanted Israel anyway. But go ahead. Verse 12.
But thou shouldest not have looked on the day of thy brother in the day that he became a stranger.
Uh-huh.
Neither shouldest thou have rejoiced over the children of Judah in the day of their destruction. Neither
yes.
shouldest thou have spoken proudly in the day of distress.
Yes.
Thou shouldest not have entered into the gate of my people in the day of their calamity.
See, thou should not have entered into the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Yea, what?
Thou shouldest not have looked on their affliction in the day of their calamity.
Uh-huh.
Nor have laid hands on their substance in the day of their calamity.
Because they came in and took it. See, look, now Israel is our land now. But go ahead, verse 14.
Neither shouldst thou have stood in the crossway to cut off those of his that did escape.
Mm.
Neither shouldst thou have delivered up those of his that did remain in the day of distress.
Mm. Verse 15.
For the day of the Lord is near upon all the heathen, as thou hast done, it shall be done unto thee. Thy reward shall return upon thine own head.
Now look at verse 21. Go ahead.
And Savior shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the Mount of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's.
So this is how you know that the Edomites have to be in the land today, because when the Lord comes back, he's going to judge them for stealing our land. So therefore, they have to be in the land now. But yet, you got people believing that the Edomites were a nation that was cut off, and they no longer exist. The reason why people think that they no longer exist, because they are under the guise of Jews, and they pretend to be our people. That's why people 36, 1 through 5. Ezekiel 36, 1 through 5. Ezekiel 36, 1 through 5. Ezekiel 36, 1 through 5. Go ahead.
Also, thou son of man, prophesy unto the mountains of Israel.
Yes.
And say, ye mountains of Israel, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God, because the enemy hath said unto you, aha, even the ancient high places are ours in possession.
Uh-huh.
Therefore prophesy and say, thus saith the Lord God, because they have made you desolate and swallowed you up on every side, that ye might be a possession unto the residue of the heathen. And ye are taken up in the lips of talkers, and are in infamy of the people. Therefore, ye mountains of Israel, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God to the mountains, and to the hills, to the rivers, and to the valleys, to the desolate wastes, and to the cities that are forsaken, which become a prey and a derision to the residue of the heathen that are round about. Mm-hmm. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God.
Listen, therefore, thus saith the Lord God, what?
Surely in the fire of my jealousy have I spoken against the residue of the heathen, and against all Idumea.
And Idumea is also Edom now, he says, therefore thus saith the Lord God, surely in the fire of my jealousy have I spoken against the residue of the heathen. Because you also remember, this also Palestinians, which are Arabs, they're also in that land, they think it's at their land as well. But look what he says, against all Idumea, which what?
Which have appointed my land into their possession.
See, they appointed the land into their possession. Because why? Because they are in the land of Israel right now, claiming to be Jews, and they're not. With what?
With the joy of all their hearts.
Uh-huh.
With despiteful minds to cast it out for a prey.
And they are destroyed and they cast it out for a prey, as it is this day. Let's go now to Ezekiel 35. Ezekiel 35, 1 through 13. Ezekiel 35, 1 through 13. When you get there, go ahead.
Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me this day. Came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Mount Seir, and prophesy against it, and say unto it, thus saith the Lord God, behold, O Mount Seir.
Mount Seir is also Edom. Go ahead.
I am against thee, and I will lay thy cities waste, and thou shalt be desolate, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord, because thou hast had a perpetual hatred, and hast shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword in the time of their calamity.
Remember, the time of calamity was around 70 AD when we got kicked out. Go ahead.
In the time that their iniquity had an end.
Uh-huh.
Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord God, I will prepare thee unto blood, and blood shall pursue thee.
Mm.
Since thou has not hated blood, even blood shall pursue thee.
Yes.
Thus will I make Mount Seir most desolate, and cut off from it him that passeth out, and him that returneth.
So when you look at Mount Seir, Petrus, Dedan, all that, you'll see like it's desolate, like it's like the clefts of the rocks of the city, but that isn't habitable because they are not in that land. They left that land, and now they're in the land of Israel because they got destroyed by the Nebatians. But go ahead.
And I will fill his mountains with the slain men.
Uh-huh.
And all, let's see, in thy hills and in thy valleys and all thy rivers shall they fall that are slain with the sword.
Uh-huh.
I will make thee perpetual desolations, and thy city shall not return.
And it did. Like I said, remember, Edom was not built back up from that time on because why? They left there and they went to Israel. Go ahead.
And ye shall know that I am the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Because thou hast said, these two nations and these two countries shall be mine, and we will possess it, whereas the Lord was there.
Right, so he says, because the Lord has said, these two nations and these two countries shall be mine, and we will possess it, whereas the Lord was there. So you look in 1948, they took Judea, and then it was 1967, during the Six-Day War, they took Samaria. So they took those two countries, and they made up theirs now. Go ahead, verse 11.
Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord God, I will even do according to thine anger and according to thine envy, which thou hast used to use out of thy hatred against them. And I will make myself known among them when I have judged thee. And thou shalt know that I am the Lord, and that I have heard all thy blasphemies, which thou hast spoken against the mountains of Israel, saying,
they are what?
They are laid desolate.
Uh-huh.
They are given us to consume.
See, so since we got kicked out of the land, they're like, see, this is desolate for us. We can take it. And that's when God said he heard them. Go ahead.
Thus with your mouth ye have boasted against me, and have multiplied your words against me. I have heard
34:1-8. Isaiah 34:1-8. So you see, like I said, so Edom is in the land right now, claiming to be Jews, and the whole world believes them because one, a lot of people lack they lack understanding of the Bible. That's why the Bible, that's why the title of the lesson, the Bible reads different when you know who the children of Israel are, because you know they cannot be in the land at this time. They will not be in the land until the Lord comes and gathers us. Go ahead. Isaiah 34:1-8. Go ahead.
Come near, you nations, to hear, and hearken, ye people. Let the earth hear, and all that is therein, the world, and all things that come forth of it. For the indignation of the Lord is upon all nations, and his fury upon all their armies. Hath heard utterly destroyed them, and he hath delivered them to the slaughter. Their slain also shall be cast out. Their stink shall come up out of their carcasses, and the mountains shall be melted with their blood, and all the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heavens shall be rolled together as a scroll, and all their hosts shall fall down as a leaf falleth off the vine, and as a fallen fig from a fig tree.
Yes.
For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Behold, it shall come down upon Idumea.
Idumea is also Edom. Go ahead.
And upon the people of my cursed judgment.
Yes.
The sword of the Lord is filled with blood. It is made fat with fatness, and with the blood of lambs and goats, and with the fat of the kidneys of rams. For the Lord hath a sacrifice in Bozrah.
There in Bozrah, also Edom.
And a great slaughter in the land of Idumea.
Yes.
And the unicorn shall come down with them, and the bullocks with the bulls, and their land shall be soaked with blood, and their dust made fat with fatness. Mm-hmm. For it is the day of the Lord's vengeance, and the year of recompenses for the controversy of Zion.
So you see, at the time, so when the Lord returns, that's what he said, when he returns, he says, for it is the day of the Lord's vengeance, and the year of recompenses for the controversy of Zion. And why is it a controversy? Because those Edomites are saying that it's their land, when it's actually our land. Let's go now to Jeremiah 49. Jeremiah 49:7-10. Jeremiah 49:7-10. See, the prophets expose them. So all we got to do is, just like I said, but when people don't read the Old Testament and say the Old Testament's done away with, we read the New Testament, like, I'm telling you, like, all the answer and the prophets, he says, I will reveal all my secrets to the prophets, and that's what he's doing. We're seeing it right here. But unfortunately, people believe that those Edomites, you can go to the prophets, they'll still say, those are the true people, and they'll tell us who are Negro, they'll say, why are you trying to steal another people's heritage? You should be happy to be African. Like, nah, we're Israelites, man. But look at this. Jeremiah 49:7-10. Go ahead.
Concerning Edom, thus saith the Lord of hosts, is wisdom no more in Teman?
Teman is also in Edom. Go ahead.
Is counsel perished from the prudent? Is their wisdom vanished? Flee ye, turn back, dwell deep, O inhabitants of Dedan.
Dedan is also Edom. Go ahead.
For I will bring the calamity of Esau upon him, the time that I will visit him. If grape gatherers come to thee, would they not leave some gleaning grapes?
Mm-hmm.
If thieves by night, they will destroy till they have enough. But I will have made Esau bare.
See, he said, but I have made Esau bare. See, he's bare. We can see him. The prophet exposed him, so we know who Esau is. Go ahead.
I have uncovered their secret places.
Yes.
And he shall not be able to hide himself. His seed is spoiled, and his brethren, and his neighbors, and he is not.
Amen. So now let's go ahead and go to Luke 13. Go to Luke 13. We're going to read 34 and 35. Just three more, two more after this. Luke 13, 34 and 35. Luke 13, 34, and 35. When you get there, go ahead.
O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, which killeth the prophets, and stonest them that are sent unto thee.
Right, because God kept sending them. Remember we read it in 2 Chronicles 36, how he kept sending the prophets. He said, until the time was enough. He said, look, you guys keep killing the prophets. I keep trying to warn you guys. But you know what? It was no more remedy. Now he said Nebuchadnezzar destroyed us in 586 B.C. But go ahead.
How often would I have gathered thy children together, as a hen doth gather her brood under her wings,
yes,
and ye would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate.
And when it means desolate, it means that because us being the original heavens, we're not in the land, but we're seeing that it's also Edomites and Palestinians. They're in that land, so it's not literally desolate. It just means that we are not into the land. Go ahead, in that land.
And verily I say unto you, you shall not see me until the time comes when ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord.
So he says, ye shall not see me until the time come when ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. We're going to see that time right now. Jeremiah 23, Jeremiah 23, 5 through 8. Jeremiah 23, 5 through 8. Jeremiah 23, 5 through 8. Now we're going to see Jesus come in the name of the Lord. And when he's going to come this time, this is when he's going to gather us and bring us back into our own land. Jeremiah 23, 5 through 8. When you get there, go ahead.
Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and the king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. In his days, Judah shall be saved,
yes,
and Israel shall dwell safely.
Right.
And this is his name, whereby he shall be called the Lord our righteous.
So you see, this righteous branch, which is Jesus, this is when he's coming in the name of the Lord, and we're going to dwell safely in that land. But what is he going to be doing at this time? Go ahead, verse 7, when he returns.
Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord,
yes,
that they shall no more say, the Lord liveth, which brought up the children out of Israel, out of the land of Egypt.
Yes.
The Lord liveth, which brought up, and which led the seed of the house of Israel out of the north country, and from all countries whither I had driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land.
And they shall dwell in their own land. So you're seeing that right now. Matter of fact, just real quick, in Zechariah chapter 8, you see, this is not going on in Israel right now, but it's showing how it's going to be that when we return. When it talks about Zechariah chapter 8, verse 3, where it says, thus say the Lord, I am returned unto Zion, and I will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem, and Jerusalem shall be called a city of truth. Right now, it's not called a city of truth right now, because those Edomites are practicing the Talmud, the Kabbalah, everything else contrary to the word of God. And the mountain of the Lord of hosts, the holy mountain. Thus said the Lord of hosts, there shall yet old men dwell in the streets of Jerusalem, and every man with a staff in his hand, for very age. And the streets of the city shall be full of boys and girls playing in the streets thereof. What you're seeing right now, they can't be playing in the streets because they got to worry about mortars and bombs being dropped on them, because you have like Hezbollah, you have all these different like proxies from Iran, like these, they're constantly going to war with Israel, so they don't have any peace in that land. And it says, verse 6, thus say the Lord of hosts, if it be marvelous in the eyes of the remnant of this people in these days, should it also be marvelous in my eyes, saith the Lord? Thus say the Lord of hosts, behold, I will save my people from east country and from the west country, and I will bring them, and they shall dwell in the midst of Jerusalem, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God in truth and in righteousness. Because at this time, God is going to purge out all the rebels that do not belong in Israel. And so every Israelite that's going to be in the land at this time are going to be righteous Israelites. But we're seeing, when they returned to the land in 1948, there's been nothing but bloodshed, nothing but chaos. You got Tel Aviv was one of the highest, gay pride parades in America, well, in the world. Like I said, America's number one, but like Tel Aviv was like number two or three. So you're just seeing that all that stuff that's going on in Israel is contrary to the word of God. So that's why you know that the children of Israel cannot be in the land at the time, at this time. Last one, Micah chapter 7. Micah chapter 7, 15 through 20. Micah chapter 7. Micah chapter 7, 15 through 20. Micah chapter 7, 15 through 20. And when you get there, go ahead.
According to the days of thy coming out of the land of Egypt, will,
yes,
I show unto him marvelous things.
Uh-huh.
The nation shall see and be confounded at all their might. They shall lay their hand upon their mouth. Their ears shall be deaf.
See, you got right, because remember, right now, everyone believed that the children of Israel came back into the land in 1948. So now the nations are going to be confounded, and they're going to be shocked. They're like, hold up, I thought they were already in the land, but yet they're going to see Jesus come back and gather us and bring us back into our land. So that's why they're going to be shocked. And that's why they're going to be what? Verse 17?
They shall lick the dust like a serpent.
Uh-huh.
They shall move out of their holes like worms of the earth.
Yes.
They shall be afraid of the Lord our God and shall fear because of thee.
Uh-huh.
Who is a God like unto thee, that pardoneth iniquity, and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage?
Yes.
He retaineth not his anger forever, because he delighteth in mercy.
Right.
He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us.
And that's what he's doing. So right now we're in the land of our captivity, where he's going to turn his compassion toward us when he gets gathered, because for his holy name's sake. Go ahead.
He will subdue our iniquities.
Yes.
And thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea.
Yes.
Thou will perform the truth of Jacob.
Yes.
And the mercy to Abraham, which thou hast sworn unto our fathers from the days of old.
And remember, he promised the land of Israel to us. Therefore, as you see, those Edomites right now are in the land claiming to be Jews, but dealing with the lesson. The Bible reads different when you know who the children of Israel are. So I pray you got some understanding in Jesus' name. Go ahead, brother.
Make sure you like, comment, subscribe your favorite part of the video. Peace. And also,